The third step of cellular respiration is oxidative phosphorylation. And I realize this is a big mouthful of a set of words, and some of you may have learned this previously as the electron transport chain. The electron transport chain is a piece of oxidative phosphorylation, but this is a better title for what's actually happening in this step. Oxidative phosphorylation, we're going to add a phosphate group to something, and oxygen is going to help us. So that is our overview of what's happening in this step. Specifically, we're going to take those loaded taxicabs that are full of hydrogens and electrons, along with the electron transport chain, to run a little machine that adds phosphates to ADP to make ATP. So let's look at a picture of how this might work. Our taxicabs are inside the mitochondria at this point, and they're going to drop off their electrons and their hydrogens. So here we have a loaded cab. It's going to drop off its electron, it's going to drop off its hydrogens, and now we have a bunch of hydrogens floating around, a bunch of electrons floating around. The electrons are going to be moved through the electron transport chain. And the electron transport chain is a series of proteins embedded in the inner matrix of the mitochondria. As these electrons move, they give off energy that helps pump hydrogen ions through existing proteins. So we have a high concentration of hydrogen ions out here, we have a low concentration, and we're pumping against the concentration gradient. So this is going to require energy, and the energy for pumping those hydrogens is going to come from the electrons moving through this electron transport system. So again, as the electrons move, they're pumping hydrogen ions against the concentration gradient, which is a form of active transport. Now we have lots of hydrogen ions on this side, not very many on this side, and so they want to flow back by diffusion through an opening. And in this case, they are going to flow back through a protein called ATP synthase. And this is a little bit like a water wheel. The hydrogen ions, as they flow back through, are going to turn a piece of this protein. And as it turns, it's going to do the work of assembling a phosphate group and ADP and building ATP. This only occurs in the presence of oxygen. So oxygen, if you remember back to our biochemistry lectures, is an electron hog. It really, really likes to hold on to electrons. It turns out it's strong enough to get all the electrons to get out of these taxicabs, these energy carriers. So if oxygen is present, it's going to pull electrons off of NADH and FADH2 through the electron transport system and gather those electrons. When it picks up enough electrons and hydrogens, it's going to react with those and become water. If there is no oxygen present, these taxicabs won't open their doors. They won't release any of their electrons. If they don't release their electrons, there's no energy to pump hydrogen ions. If there's no energy to pump hydrogen ions, there won't be enough hydrogen ions to flow back through ATP synthase, and you won't make ATP. So this may sound a little dramatic, but the reason that you die if you stop breathing is you shut down this system. No oxygen, no electron pump, no hydrogen pump, no ATP being made. This process is way more efficient than step one or step two, which remember only net you two ATPs each. This process can generate up to 34 ATPs per individual glucose. So this is really where we get most of our ATP. It occurs in the inner membrane of the mitochondria, and it's going to produce water as a waste product. FADH and NADH, our empty taxicabs, are just going to return to the Krebs cycle and to glycolysis so that they can load up and shuttle more hydrogens and electrons back and forth. So one more video to sort of illustrate what happens in step three of cellular respiration.